All right, let's go ahead and take our Bibles tonight and come to the book of Daniel. The book of Daniel. I'd like to thank everyone for being here this evening. The book of Daniel, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, if you're new to the Bible. It's going to be slightly to the right of the middle of your Bible. Daniel chapter 10, and in Daniel chapter 10, come to verse 10. Daniel chapter 10, verse 10. The Bible says, "And behold, an hand touched me, which set me upon my knees and upon the palm of my hands. And he said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto thee, and stand upright, for unto thee am I now sent. And when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling." Now, we're not told who is speaking to Daniel here in chapter 10, but at the end of chapter 9, it was Gabriel. And so we have every reason to believe that it's Gabriel that once again is speaking to Daniel here. Now, there are only two angels in the Bible that are ever given by name. One, of course, is Michael the archangel, and then the other is Gabriel. In verse 12, the Bible says, "Then he said unto me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard, and I am come for thy words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 120 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief priests, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia." Now I want you to stop for a second and think about this. In 2 Kings chapter 19, verse 35, the Bible tells us that one angel, one solitary angel, slew 185,000 men. Now that's a massacre of epic proportions. And yet here's Gabriel, who, since he's only one of two named angels in the Bible, we know that he has to be a prominent and powerful angel. The Bible says that this prince of Persia withstood him for 21 days. That's 3 weeks. And so you can say what you want to, whoever this prince of Persia is, he's not someone who originated on this earth. Amen. Verse 14, "Now I am come to make thee understand what shall befall thy people, Israel, in the latter days, for yet the vision is many days. And when he had spoken such words unto me, I set my face towards the ground, and I became dumb. And behold, one like the similitude of the sons of men touched my lips. Then I opened my mouth and spake and said unto him that stood before me, O my Lord, by the vision my sorrows are turned upon me, and I have retained no strength. For how can the servant of this my Lord talk with this my Lord? For as for me, straightway there remained no strength in me, neither is there breath left in me. Then there came again and touched me one like the appearance of a man, and he strengthened me, and said, O man greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be unto thee, be strong. Yea, be strong. And when he had spoken unto me, I was strengthened, and said, Let my Lord speak, for thou hast strengthened me. And he said, Knowest thou wherefore I am come unto thee? And now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I am gone forth, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come. But I will show thee that which is noted in the scripture of truth. And there is none that holdeth with me in these things, but Michael, your prince." Let's pray. Our Father and God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to be here tonight. And Lord, we thank you for this book. And Lord, I thank you that tonight I hold a book that is perfect, infallible, inerrant, inspired in every way. And whereas I am imperfect, this book is completely perfect. Amen. And Lord, I pray that you would speak to us through this book tonight. I pray that your Holy Spirit might fall upon this place and prepare our hearts to receive the word that you intend for us to have. And Lord, I pray that we can leave this place better than when we came in. And Lord, I pray that we can put these things to good use in the coming days ahead. And Lord, we'll thank you for these things and praise you for these things. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. For a few moments tonight, I'd like to preach on the subject of the real modern warfare. The real modern warfare. You know, I don't know how familiar you are with video games and things like that, but there's a video game called Modern Warfare. There's a whole series of games, and these are war games that, use modern warfare as far as images from Iraq and Afghanistan and things like that. And a lot of young people and even a lot of adults are very interested in this video game. And my boys like to play it and so forth. They've always been fascinated with things about the military since Dad is in the military. And so there's these video games called Modern Warfare. But I want you to understand tonight that as a Christian, like it or not, you are involved in modern warfare.
That's right.
And I want to talk for a few moments this evening about the type of warfare that you and I are engaged in. Here in the book of Daniel, for just a few moments, the Lord pulls back the curtain, if you will, a little bit, to give us an idea of what goes on in the heavenlies. He gives us an idea of what goes on in the spirit world. Now, I'm not a charismatic, and I'm not a Pentecostal, but I do believe in a spirit world. And I'm afraid that sometimes as Baptists, we like to pretend that the spirit world does not exist, but it does. And for just a few moments here in Daniel chapter 10, we see that this spirit world is a place where conflict and warfare takes place. We see that Gabriel and Michael, two of God's most powerful angels, are having combat with this prince of Persia and this prince of Grecia. And what that shows me is this, is that the kingdoms of this earth that are on this earth physically, they have representation in the heavenlies, in the spirit world, and some of that representation is evil. And certainly that was the case as far as the king of Grecia and the king of Persia that were fighting against Michael, because who does Michael stand for?
Israel.
Israel. And is it any small wonder that of all the nations on the earth tonight, the one that is still the most hated and the still the most despised is the nation of Israel, God's chosen people. And so we see that this spirit world exists, and we see that there is a combat or a warfare that's going on. Now, you and I have a role to play in this. Take your Bibles for a moment, if you would, and come to the book of Ephesians. Come to the book of Ephesians. When you got saved, whether you knew it or not, you basically defected from the devil's army, and you enlisted in the Lord's army. Amen. Ephesians chapter 2 shows us this. Ephesians chapter 2, come to verse number 1. Ephesians 2:1. In Ephesians 2:1 it says, "And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins." Now notice that word quickened. You know, down south we say that if a person cuts their fingernails too short, they cut into what?
The quick.
The quick. And what's that a reference to? It's a reference to that living flesh that's underneath that dead nail of yours. And so we say that that person cut into the quick. And so anyone that says that the King James Bible is out of date and uses archaic language, evidently they ain't a Southerner, because if they was a Southerner, they'd understand what that word meant.
Amen.
So you hath he quickened, you hath he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. The spirit, do you see that? The
yeah.
Spirit that now, present tense, right now, 2013, worketh in the children of disobedience. Now watch verse 3. Among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God. Don't you love it when God butts in? When God butts in, things change. Things get different. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love, wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace, you're saved.
Amen.
So thank God that the Lord butted in into a hopeless situation and delivered us from the power of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of light and the kingdom of his dear Son. And so, but when we did that, when we defected from Satan's army, when we basically went UA, as the Navy would say, unauthorized absence, AWOL, as the Army might say, when we left the devil's charge and joined the Lord's army, we certainly do not think that the devil is going to just sit idly by and take kindly to that, right? Of course not. And so when you left the devil's army and joined the Lord's army, what you did is you engaged or entered into spiritual warfare. And unfortunately tonight, many Christians are ignorant of the spiritual warfare that they are in tonight. And so the purpose of my message this evening is to remind us that we are engaged in spiritual warfare and to give us some tools to help us understand how we can wage this warfare successfully and win. Because in warfare, you don't want to be on the losing side. You want to be on the winning side. You know, I'm glad that we won World War II. I'm glad that tonight I'm not speaking German. I'm glad tonight that I'm not speaking Russian. I'm glad that we won that war and defended this world against tyranny from the Nazis and the Japanese Empire and so forth. And so I'm glad that we won that victory. Well, listen here. We want to be on the winning side here as well. Now, I know ultimately that we are on the winning side because I've read the end of the book, amen. And guess what? We win.
Amen. Amen.
Revelation says so. We win. But watch this. I want us, those of us that are here and anyone else that would hear this message, I want us to be in the best possible shape we can be when we do win. Amen. I don't want us to show up mutilated and scarred and defeated. I want us to show up victorious with a smile on our face, yes. A song in our heart, and a shout coming out of our mouth. Amen.
Amen, brother.
And so modern warfare. Now the first thing I'd have you to notice about this warfare is the nature of our warfare. I'd have you to notice the nature of our warfare. Look at Ephesians 6. You're in Ephesians 2. Go ahead and come to Ephesians 6 and notice what it says here. Notice the nature of our warfare. In Ephesians 6, look at verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of what?
His might.
Whose might?
His might.
So it's not your might.
No.
It's his might, right? The arm. What's the old hymn say? The arm of flesh will fail you. Ye dare not trust your own. Right? Jesus said, the spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is what? So we are not trusting in our might or our power. We are trusting in His. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Now, the word wiles, it means trickery or deceit. Of course, Satan is a subtle one. Listen here. He came to Eve subtly and through his subtlety tricked her into partaking of that fruit that God had said not to partake of. And so if he could do that with Eve, he can probably do the same thing with you and I. And so Paul reminds us here to be weary of these wiles of the devil. And he says to put on this whole armor of God. Now, if you talk to a soldier or you talk to a Marine, there's a certain combat load that they're expected to wear. They're expected to wear a Kevlar helmet to protect their head. They're expected to wear a flak jacket with sappy plates that will protect them against ballistics to the trunk of the body to protect the vital organs. You'll find that they wear certain things around their waist to protect their loins and things like that. And so there's certain battle gear that's expected of a soldier or a Marine. And so the same thing here. Notice it says verse 11, this armor of God. Now verse 12 is the key because this shows us the nature of the warfare that we're in. He says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Do you see that?
Yes, sir.
Now, I realize that there probably aren't too many fans of President Obama here tonight. But let me say that our battle tonight is not with President Obama.
Right.
Our battle is not with the Congress, be they Democrat or be they Republican. Our battle is not with any flesh and blood entity. Our battle is a spiritual battle. Notice what it says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness in this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places.
Amen.
Now, we can spiritualize that passage and say that refers to Congress or Washington, D.C. or whatever, but you can say what you want to. The spiritual wickedness in high places that we're concerned about tonight is the ones that pulls the strings on Congress, that pulls the strings on the president, that pulls the strings on the different leaders of this world. Because behind the scenes, it's the prince of Grecia. It's the prince of Persia. It's Satan himself pulling the strings. Now, understand that the kingdoms of this world right now do not belong to God.
No, sir.
Permissively, he has allowed the devil to have control of them. Now, when Jesus Christ comes back, Revelation 11:15 says that the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our God and of his Christ. So that's going to happen in the future, but it hasn't happened yet. When Jesus stood before Satan on the Mount of Temptation, Satan said, "All this I will give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me." Did Jesus contradict what he said? Did Jesus say, "Oh, Satan, you don't have that to give"? No, Jesus didn't say anything in rebuttal to that. He simply said, "The Lord thy God shall thou worship, and him only shalt thou serve." He didn't say anything about it. Oh, Lucifer or Satan, you're telling a lie there. No. Why didn't he say that? Because the devil does have power over the kingdoms right now. You know, how do you explain how an Adolf Hitler comes to power? Or a Saddam Hussein? Or a Joseph Stalin? Or a Mussolini? Or all these other murderous dictators that have come to power down through the years? Do you think that was God's purpose and God's plan? Now, certainly, God's permissive will allowed it to happen, and he sets up who he'll set up, and he takes down who he'll take down, but it's the devil that puts those type of men in power. And so, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against the powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, verse 14, having your loins girt about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Now notice when he talks about this armor, he talks about a helmet. All right, the helmet, the purpose of the helmet is to protect your head. And so if you take a blow to the head, your brain can suffer damage. You can't think, you can't breathe, and so forth and so on. So the head is something important to protect. Then he talks about this breastplate of righteousness. And certainly the breastplate, the purpose of the breastplate is to protect those vital organs, the heart, the lungs, the liver, and so forth. And then he talks about having the shield of faith. And notice that shield, that's defensive. That's to parry blows from a sword or to, take the impact of darts and things like that. And so when you look at this armor, there's two particular areas of the Bible that are not covered. Two particular areas. One, your shins or your lower legs. And two, your back. And there's a reason for that. The reason why your shins are not protected, because this is a battle that the Christian soldier rages on his knees.
Oh, wow. Amen.
Your shins aren't protected because if you're on your knees like you should be, your shins are protected by the ground.
Amen.
And so your shins are not armored because the Christian wages this battle on his knees in prayer and supplication to God. The second part of your body that's not covered is your back. And the reason why your back is never covered is because of God before us, who can be against us. The Christian should never have to retreat.
Well, that's right.
Amen.
A Christian should never have to retreat. And so our legs are not covered because we fight this battle on our knees in prayer. And our backs aren't covered because we never have to retreat, because greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world.
Amen.
And so it's a spiritual battle. Now, I'd have you to notice not just the nature of our warfare, but secondly, I'd have you to notice the leader of our warfare. Take your Bibles for a moment and come to the book of Hebrews. Come to Hebrews and come to Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2. Of course, that's going to be towards the back of your Bible. Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2 and look at verse 10. Hebrews 2:10. And we'll probably back up a couple verses just to get a context. Hebrews chapter 2, look at verse 9. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. For it became him, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, and bringing many sons into glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. Do you see that? The captain of our salvation. And so, I don't know how many of you have a military background. I know that some of you do. And so you understand rank structure and so forth. But a captain is a leader of men. And listen here, a captain sets a standard for his men to follow. an example in leadership. And that's certainly what the Lord Jesus Christ did for us. And that's why we have confidence in our warfare, is because of the caliber of the leader that we have. You see, our leader is God manifest in the flesh. Our leader is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Our leader is I Am. He is the God of heaven. He's God manifest in the flesh. He cannot lie. He cannot be defeated. He's all-powerful. He's omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent. Therefore, I can have confidence in a leader like that.
Amen.
Listen here. I may fail you as a leader. You know why? Because I'm a flesh and blood human being. I'm a sinner capable of failing you and letting you down. Pastor Gibson, if he were here tonight, he would tell you the same thing, that he's a sinner like unto you, and it's possible for him to fail you and let you down. We have all experienced leaders in our lives that in one way or another have let us down. And the reason is because all of them are imperfect as human beings and sinners. But we've got a leader, a captain of our salvation, who leads us in this warfare, and it's not possible for him to let us down.
That's right. Amen, brother.
You know why? Because he's already won the victory.
Amen.
He won the victory on Calvary. He won the victory when he shed his blood as an atonement for our sins. He cried out, "It is finished," and they took him down from that cross. They put him in a borrowed tomb, and they thought that that was the end of this man. But on that third and glorious day, he rose again with great power and now sits upon the right hand of the Father, ready, willing, and able to save anyone that'll come to him by faith. And Paul said that had the principalities of this world known what would have happened, they would have never crucified the Lord of glory.
Amen. Amen. That's true.
Can you imagine the shock on Satan's face when Jesus came up out of that grave?
Amen.
Oh, my goodness. You know, they say a picture's worth a thousand words. I'd pay a lot of money to see that expression. And so we see the leader of our warfare. So not just the nature of our warfare, but the leader of our warfare. Now, thirdly, I'd like to talk about this, the weapons of our warfare. The weapons of our warfare. You know, you're not a very good soldier if you don't know how to use your weapons. Take your Bible and come, if you will, please, to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, Paul has something to say about weapons, the weapons of our warfare. Notice what he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, come to verse 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1. "Now I, Paul, beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who am present and base among you, but being absent and bold towards you, but I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present, with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh." Now watch verse 3. "For though we walk in the flesh," we are in fleshly tabernacles. We are in these bodies of clay that God has put us in. "For though we do walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons," verse 4, "the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, Amen. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled." Now notice he says, the weapons of our warfare, they are not carnal. In other words, they are not physical. They are not fleshly. He says, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Now, what are some of these weapons? Well, I'm sure that you could come up with several, but there are three primary weapons that I would like to speak of this evening, that if you will take heed to these weapons and learn how to use them and use them properly and use them faithfully, I believe that you can fight a successful warfare. Come back to Ephesians chapter 6 for a moment. Ephesians chapter 6. Now, aren't you glad we can study the Bible tonight? Amen. We can go scripture with scripture, comparing spiritual things with spiritual things, comparing things which are alike, contrasting things which are different. Notice in Ephesians chapter 6, we come back to these passages where Paul was speaking of the armor of God. And armor, is armor defensive or offensive?
Defensive.
Defensive in the sense that armor, the purpose of armor is for protection. And so it's defensive in nature. Offensive is something that you attack with.
Right.
You don't attack with a helmet. You don't attack with a breastplate. You don't attack with a shield. You attack with a sword.
Right.
Notice what it says. Verse 17. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is what?
The Word of God.
The Word of God. The first weapon that you need to understand, that you need to master and learn how to use, is the Word of God. The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Take your Bibles for a moment and come to Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4. In Hebrews chapter 4, look with me if you would please at verse number 12. Hebrews 4:12. Hebrews 4:12 says this, "For the Word of God is quick." Now, what do we say that word quick means?
Alive.
Alive. So if the Word of God is quick, what is it?
It's alive.
It's alive. "For the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." Now, you can say what you want to, but this book is alive.
Amen.
It is a living entity. And when you come to this Bible is a discerner of your heart. It knows the intent with which you've come. Have you ever come to your Bible and you've read and you were reading out of a sense of duty? You were tired, you were ready for bed, but you knew that you needed to read your Bible to end the day, and so you spent 30 minutes, 15 minutes, whatever, in the Word of God, and it just seems dry, it seems dull, your heart's not really in it, and you really didn't get anything out of it, and you go to bed basically bored. You know why that happened? Because that book discerned the thoughts and intents of your heart. That book knew why you came before you came. And you didn't come looking for anything, so the book didn't give you anything.
That's right. That's right.
But if you come with the right heart and the right attitude and say, "Lord, open thy servant's eyes that I may behold marvelous things from thy law." If you come to that book with the right heart and the right attitude, listen here, God will start showing you some things. Listen here, you ever got a hold of your Bible and started reading that thing and you just couldn't put it down?
Yeah.
You know, there's sometimes in my flesh, I don't even want to pick this book up.
That's right.
You know why? Because D.L. Moody said this book will keep you from sin, or sin will keep you from this book.
All right.
And so usually when I've desired not to pick this book up, it's because there was unconfessed sin in my life.
Right.
But you know what? There's been other times where I've come to that book with a hunger and with a desire to hear from God. And that book discerned the thought and intent of my heart and gave me exactly what I needed and started filling my cup up till it was overflowing, and I didn't even want to put that book down.
That's right.
Amen.
I enjoy those much more than the former, that's for sure. And so here it says that the Word of God is sharper than a two-edged sword. Paul said in Ephesians that the Word of God is the sword of the Spirit. So notice that the Word of God, and I don't have time to get into this as far as turning into the passages, but here's your homework assignment. I want you to go to Acts chapter, write this down, because I don't want you to forget. I want you to go to Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 9 on your own time. And I want you to notice how in Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 9, it says that they were pricked in their heart. Right?
Right.
Then I want you to go to Acts chapter 5 and then go to Acts chapter 7. And I want you to notice where it says that they were cut in their heart.
Yeah.
And here's the difference. In Acts 2:38, the Bible says that they were pricked in their hearts and said, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" And Peter responded and said, "Repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." You know what? They were pricked in their heart. They were under conviction. On that road to Damascus, you know, Paul, when he saw the Lord on the way to Damascus, the Lord said, "It's hard for thee to kick against the pricks."
Right.
What pricks? The pricks in his heart. Saul of Tarsus in his own conscience knew that what he was doing was wrong.
Right.
And so it was hard for him to kick against the pricks. Here's the difference. When the Word of God pricks your heart, it pricks you to repentance and you get right with God.
Amen.
But if you contrast that with Acts chapter 5 and Acts chapter 7, where it says they were cut to the heart. When a man gets cut to the heart, he gets cut to rejection of the Word of God. It's a two-edged sword. It'll prick you to repentance, or it'll cut you to rejection. And it's all based on the kind of heart you have. And don't forget that the book's already told you that it's able to discern the thoughts and intents of your heart. This book is not something to be messed with. This book is not something to be played around with. This is serious business, folks. And so the nature of our warfare, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. And so the first one is the Word of God. I want to say this. The second one is fasting. Fasting. Now, fasting is not a popular topic in Baptist churches. It is not a common topic in Baptist churches. I was very blessed to spend a year and a half at Lighthouse Baptist Church in Lemon Grove, California, with Pastor Doug Fisher. And Pastor Fisher is very much into fasting. And listen here, in that church, people fast individually. They fast corporately together as a church. And fasting is a very, very important part of the church. And you know what? God has poured out so many blessings upon them that they can scarcely receive them all. And I really believe that a lot of that is due to the fact that he fasts and has taught his church to fast. Amen. And fasting has become a lost art. But I want you to notice something. If you'll come to Matthew chapter 6, and I know that some of the brethren sometimes they like to say, well, that's Matthew and dispensationalist to the Jews and all that. And I agree, and I believe in rightly dividing the word of truth and recognizing divisions in the word of God. But there's some things that's just true for all of us. I don't care what the dispensation is. Notice in Matthew chapter 6, come to verse 16. Verse 16. Jesus says, moreover, when ye fast. Now, that one word, when, is key. Because the Bible didn't say, if ye fast. He said, when ye fast. You know what? Jesus just kind of takes it for granted that his disciples are going to fast. Remember back in the book of Daniel, when we first started tonight, Daniel chapter 10, where it said that Daniel afflicted and chastised his soul and so forth. Guess what that means? He was fasting, brother. He was fasting. That's how he afflicted himself before the Lord. He was fasting. And notice that if someone would try to say that this is dispensationally to the Jews and the Sermon on the Mount and all that, well, fine. Take your Bibles and come to Acts chapter 13 and come to the age of grace with the Apostle Paul, who was the apostle to who?
Gentiles.
The Gentiles. Acts chapter 13. Acts chapter 13. Now, there were in the church that was in Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manaen, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. And as they ministered to the Lord and what?
Fasted.
Wait a minute. Here's New Testament saints fasting.
That's right.
The Holy Ghost said, separate me Barnabas and Saul for the work whereunto I have called them. And when they had fasted, well, they was already fasting, so evidently they fasted some more and prayed and laid their hands on them and sent them away. Listen here, the reason why the church doesn't have the power it used to have, the reason why individual Christians don't have the power that we used to have, is we've forgotten how to fast.
That's right, brother. Amen.
And we've dismissed the importance of fasting, and here's what we've done. One of the most lethal weapons that we have in our arsenal against Satan, we don't use it.
Wow.
That's right, brother. You're right.
We don't use it. Imagine a Marine that has an M16, but he won't use his 50 cal.
Oh, wow.
You know, imagine using a 9mm pistol when you have like a 240 Gulf that you could use. And so that's what's going on in churches today. That's what's going on in the lives of believers. We have a weapon that we don't use. Notice, if you will, come to Matthew 17. Matthew 17.